I'm the co-owner and founder of Limited Run Games. My panel, we're going to talk about Limited Run, we're going to talk about me a little, we're going to talk about Limited Run, and we're going to talk about how you might have questions. And that's about it. So here we go. This is PowerPoint. This is going to be, it's going to be insane. Yeah, we got your graphics. It's afternoon in Joker Man font with Limited Run Games. My first panel. Oh, our initial struggles were basically creating and finding a shipping partner. When we first started, I shipped all the Bridge Clears out. I shipped all of Saturday Morning out, and I shipped most of Aqua World myself. And it was terrible. So you start blacking out at points, and you start reprinting the same label over and over, and next thing you know, some customer's like, hey, I ended up with 5 copies, and I only ordered 1. If he was nice enough to tell you. I doubt he'd be able to do that now. I was also customer support. So for those two, we got to a point where shipping partner wise, it was about probably around Shadow Complex. We got a shipping partner that was local, and they were like, hey, we can ship stuff out. And it turned out they couldn't. They had no idea that these were collectibles, and they were packaging them terribly. They were going missing. They weren't even getting the idea that, like, this postcard that clearly shows this game needs to go with this game. They were mixing those up. It was terrible. So then we dropped them. We got a new partner. They did a great job. We only recently switched one more time because they raised their rates. While we may end up going back to them, there's just like other things. Customer support wise, we now have 3 support people instead of just me. They got to the point where my answers started becoming paragraphs to a sentence to like, okay. And like people are like, oh, your customer support sucks. You guys are mean and rude. And I'm like, I just wrote 1 letter. How's that mean? So I couldn't deal with it. I was also the guy in charge of signing games and also going to events, so there was no way I could also be doing customer support. The other thing that was our initial struggle was convincing developers what we do is real and not a scam. So when we first started, we had only done Breach and Clear, and we went to our first event, which was BSX. So I went there to recruit more developers, and I was basically walking around with Breach and Clear saying, like, hey, this is a thing I can do for you. And they were like, I've never heard of this, and this looks like something you may have just made in your garage. And I was like, it's real. So now I don't really have that problem because we've done a lot of bigger titles, but it was a huge struggle at first. Even after we'd done Oddworld, people were like, oh, this looks like something a fan made that was just really well done. And I was like, no, it's what? How? And telling people, like, no, we don't print these. Sony prints these. That was another thing that people always were like, how do you guys make these with Sony not suing you? And I'm like, what? Like, obviously Sony did this. This is, like, their case. The other thing was getting press coverage. Like, I can't tell you how many times I would tell, like, email somebody and they just come back. Why they wouldn't come back. That's the thing. They just, nobody cared. Some of the early successes with that was reaching out to Mike Fahey from Kotaku. He was a huge Saturday Morning RPG fan. He's, like, the only person that liked the game in the press, or at least the one that I paid attention. So I was like, hey, we're doing this thing. So he wrote about us. Game Informer was tricky. That was probably when we finally started getting noticed. I had to reach out to them. I even called them. I started stalking them on Twitter. I even signed up for LinkedIn Pro, just for like the free month, just so I could get their emails. And like, eventually it worked, and we got a 2-page spread in one of their summer issues. I think it was the South Park issue, actually, the new one that's coming out. We had a 2-page spread where they spelled my co-founder's name 3 different ways. I was okay. So that's all I care about. And then we started getting more stuff. There's still websites that still don't seem to care about what we do. GameSpot, like, people there love me, and like, well, I don't know about that. People there know who I am, and they talk to me, and like, I've never ever seen anything reported by us. That's still a struggle. Now Game Informer, Polygon eventually talks about us sometimes, very rarely, a struggle away. So like, we're finally getting out there. That was probably the toughest thing. Well, actually, the toughest thing right now is the last part. Finding the right unit size to sell out. So again, I don't want to end up with these games not selling out because then I'm sitting on inventory that I have to somehow find a way to sell in order to pay the developer. It also looks bad. So if the games don't sell out and people tell the other people, like, hey, this game's still in stock, they're like, oh, well, you know, maybe I'll get it today. And then, like, they never show back up. Because there's no sense of urgency. The other problem is, if there's no sense of urgency, the word of mouth is even spread. There's no hype. There's no like, oh, I get this game. This game didn't sell out, and it'll probably never get fans. But the idea behind our releases is that they hold their value. We don't want our developers to feel like they're the ones that get fans. We want to be able to sell out and make sure that they got their money to work on their next game. Or like, one guy took his entire studio out to Tokyo because they already had money for the next game. So he was able to do something nice for his studio. That was the guy who made Octodad. So I thought that was really awesome. Like posting pictures, and it's just like, wow, we were able to help these guys take a break. So that's why we do it. It's we don't actually retain that much money from these. We do a lot of this to help. So we take a very, very fair cut, like industry standard. a lot of people always tell me that you should take more, and I'm like, I can't. Like, I feel that. Our future plans are to increase our customer base and the print size. The reason why I want press coverage, and I know people get mad about that, they're like, oh, more people know, I can't get it. Well, the idea is if I have more people signing up for the mailing list, more people visiting the website, I can judge, I can say, okay, it looks like we need to print more. So, like with Night Trap, you know, man, get this out there. When we signed that game, it was at 4,000 copies. The guy who had that game had no idea what was in his hands. He was like, oh, you know, I'm remastering the game, I'm making it. You know, it's pretty cool. I've always wanted to just own a game I've worked on. I'd be like, okay, well, you realize this is Night Trap, right? And he was like, yeah. And we're like, no, you don't. we were like, this had a huge impact in America. This is the reason why we have the ESRB, one of the reasons. And, you know, it's just one of those classic bad games. Like, you need it. So we announced it, and it was everywhere. It was on every website. It was like everybody was talking about. We gained like 4,000 more followers on Twitter, which was insane. And it was just, we went back to them and said, we don't have enough. And we're like, what about 8? And we'll do like a collector's edition. And honestly, at the time, we still thought that was right. The only reason we couldn't increase it further was because the lead time for the vinyl and the collector's edition was too far. Like, we had to have that done like 6 months before. That being said, we could have probably printed 2,000 more. The idea is if we build the customer base and have a better gauge, we'll be able to print more. And we're coming up with ideas to help like alleviate that. Like, maybe something I've always wanted to do is create a mailing list that's catered to that release, kind of like Loot Crate does. So that way you know how many people are hyped for that game. Because there's a lot of people that bought Night Trap that aren't ever coming back and don't care about anything else. They just wanted that game because it meant something. We're also trying to work on better community and interaction. That one's kind of a weird catch-22, because a lot of people like to say, Linda Run, you guys are so defensive. And it's like, yeah, because we own the company, and we want to tell you the truth. Like, if I say, hey, these games aren't made yet because Sony's in peak production, I don't want to hear, well, quit blasting the blame to Sony. It's like, well, that's literally the reason. Like, what do you mean? I'm not mad at them. I know why. They're printing Destiny 2. Like, we're such a little small fish in that pond. Like, it makes sense. I'm not mad. Like, they've done so much for us. Like, never write it to me. So it's just one of those things where, like, Josh and I are very hands-on in the entire process. There's 11 employees now, but for, like, the first year and a half, it was just me and him. So, like, we care. Like, we try to interact as best we can. That's why the way we're working it now is, like, if you follow us on Twitter, you'll notice that Josh and I usually respond to anybody that replies, because sometimes I don't even know who I'm talking to. That guy could have ended up being, like, a huge Twitch person. And if I had said the wrong thing to him, that's another PR nightmare for me. Because people love to screen cap things now. For one, like, example of that is one time I said, I don't think you're a true Vita fan if you have a PlayStation TV and no Vita. That still continues to haunt me. It's people's signatures on some forums.
That's right.
Yeah.
You're right.
Yeah. I just feel like if you're a real Vita fan, you own the Vita, because PSTV doesn't even support all the Vita stuff. So I still kind of think that, but I definitely worded that the wrong way. And I even had a couple people in the press go, like, oh, they don't care about their Vita fans. And I'm like, what? I just made a really bad comment. So the idea is to not do that anymore. Try to stay positive. PlayStation TV is awesome. Go buy it. Go find it. Our other plan right now is to start bringing titles over. So the Vita is going to run dry. There's just not enough out there. And the stuff that is left is really cheap. Like, I had a developer reach out to me recently, and their games are good. They're both $2. I can't discuss what the actual price to produce a Vita is, Vita card, but it's expensive. It costs way more than PS4 does. And there's no way I could sustain a run size that would cover all this and convince people to do it. So we need to start looking for games that haven't made it over, or games that just, like, seem impossible. Like, there's a Cinderella Cogger game called Bon Appetit on Vita that I really want. That's been, like, my dream project right now. And it only ever got a physical in Hong Kong, strictly in Chinese, and then Japan. And it's all in Japanese. There's never been a physical English one, which is weird. Every other game in the series has had one, aside from the first one. So that's something I'd like to do. And then, like, for example, we wanted Drive Rules, which is apparently not that great, but I still wanted it because it's ridiculous. But Axis just announced that they have it, and Rising Star has it for Europe. So that's the idea we want to do. Like, we want to bring games over that, like, some of the bigger boys decided not to touch. Maybe there's a game like they didn't want. So right now we're working on trying to get a visual novel from Japan. It's never been translated for Vita, it's been translated for Steam. So we're working on that right now, trying to get all that finalized. And that's the idea that we want to do. It's interesting. We want to get all the DLC that we can and make an awesome collector's edition. And then that way we have something else that nobody else is going to have. The other thing we're going to do is maybe start publishing digitally. That goes hand in hand with localization. If we're paying all this money to localize the game, we might as well publish it. But the idea is that we keep the splits the same, which is already the industry standard. I'm not trying to own the product, but so far one of the things we're talking about is going to basically, they retain all the rights, like merchandising, final approval of everything. I'm very lenient with this. I'm doing this to help the developer, so I want the developer to keep as much control as they can. This way, it helps keep us funded if there's another issue at Sony where they're like, oh, we're bringing Destiny 3, you know, 5 years ahead of time. And we can't bring your games for like a solid 6 months. I have an additional revenue stream. This gives me a chance to start doing other ideas we've had, like maybe being an official license to pros. That was another idea we were like throwing around. We have a lot of like good ideas, but money is always a concern. And then now that we have, so this is the issue we're having right now, is we have so much signed when we first started that there are not enough weeks in the year. Customers are always complaining that too much. And I understand that. It is a lot. I get the same way when I go on Amazon and they're like, oh, there's 10 new games coming out this month. I'm like, I want all of them. I have to choose. And our customers feel like they're forced to buy ours because they are limited. There's no chance to choose. So the idea now is we're going to have to start going after more mid-tier to high-tier games. Kind of like Night Traps. We need more Night Traps. We need more East Origin, more Wonder Boys. We're at a position now where people know who we are, so we have a better sway in this. We have a better, like, negotiating tactic. Like, I'm not a scam anymore. People know who I am. Well, the company. So that's what we're going to start doing. It's question time. I'll just wrap it up before I get to that, though. Again, trying to print more games. Start localizing. Start doing digital stuff, hopefully. We're gonna start branching out to other platforms. So we've been talking with Microsoft for a long time, nothing set in stone yet, but we're hoping to get on there at some point. Again, it's a lot harder to work with Microsoft just because they have a lot more rules that the company as a whole enforces. And then we'd love to get on Nintendo one day, but that's its own thing, and we're just gonna be patient for now. But Nintendo would be a great option to be, Switch is really popular. God, I wish I had more dumb slides. Oh, yeah, I did. Look at that. You can follow us on our website, LimitedRunGames.com. There's a mailing list. And then we have our Twitter, at LimitedRunGames, and then at LimitedRunHub, is me. At LimitedRunJosh is also the other founder you can follow on there. Our CFO, who has a lot of good inside tips, because he's kind of our guy who got us established with our shipping partner, and he also got us established with the company that creates our collector's editions. He has a lot of, like, cool, if you ever want to know insider stuff, he's Mighty Men, because he originally started with Mighty Rabbit, so. I'll take questions now. Yeah, Mighty Men.
Okay.
And that's his legal name. Go ahead.
Would you consider doing that,
like to keep their game sealed. I do the same thing if I bought a game on a PSN sale because those flash sales popped up. I'm like, oh, it's under $5. Done. Don't really have to think about $5. But then, like, a month later, I'll find it at the store on clearance too, like Minecraft. I own Minecraft so many times since I've had one. I'm just like, I don't even care anymore. I'll buy it physically if it's on clearance or on a sale, but I'm not going to open it because I have it digitally. So that's, I understand our customers would like to do that too. Anybody else? We do that for Black Friday. We'll have something similar to that. So the idea is to get rid of all our remaining stock, because we reserve a good percentage for replacements and for stolen items, because it happens, especially overseas. So we can't, it would be really dumb of me to say, hey, we printed 8,000 and I sold them for 8,000. I'd be screwed. Because I'd rather the customer get a replacement than just get them a refund. So the idea is that once the year's over, if I've gotten back some that are slightly damaged or I just have perfectly sealed ones, we will sell them on like a holiday event or something and it'll be announced. But yes, absolutely. So, yes?
You consider doing like a pre-sale for the higher profile stuff on Minecraft?
Since you asked this and I was going to save it for the end, this will be a raise your hands. How many people here are excited for Isori? Anybody? Yeah? Okay. Probably one of our second highest, most hyped release right now. The idea is, so I've gotten like death threats and go kill yourself and I hate you, you suck, F you after Wonder Boy Night Trap, which honestly, as bad as that sounds, I'm starting to get used to it. Which I think that sounds worse. The idea that they were thrown around the office, and we haven't discussed this actually that much other than a quick phone call while I was traveling, is that with Peace Origin, we've already announced what the cover looks like. We've already, well, have we? Yeah, I don't even know what we do yet. We announced that there's a collector's edition. We haven't shown much of it yet. I know that. And then the idea is that we offer that one, we keep it the way it is, with the limit, and then we offer another cover, that like another cover variant, and we have that for like a 24-hour pre-order. Is that something that interests anybody?
Yes.
Yeah.
I think that's a great idea, because it keeps the original one still limited.
Yeah.
It gives you another option.
Does, and then it's still, like you said, it's limited.
And it helps you guys too, you can figure out how to order that way.
Yeah, so, and we would let people know, because a lot of times we order these games in advance, so if we do this pre-order one, it will ship later, and we'll just make sure that's all over the page, which, that doesn't do anything, but, I think that's a good idea, and I think we'll test it with this version, so if that doesn't work, I can officially say pre-orders don't work, and here's why. Because everybody likes to say that Skullgirls was a bad test. Oh yeah, I should have said that at the beginning of the thing. Skullgirls is coming, just calm down. Skullgirls, people like to say it's a bad test because the actual file itself was not ready and it wasn't manufactured, and that's why it's been delayed. But something like with East, everything's approved, it's just not manufactured for that new cover. So that would be a better idea to try. And I'm willing to do it just to see if it works. And if it does, that would be an example of like, crap, we could have made even more money than Night Trap and Wonder Boy for the devs by doing this, but we really just were terrified of pre-orders after Skullgirls. And you had a question next?
Yeah, actually, so I know that people buy their own games almost religiously. Would you rent like a subscription?
Ooh, subscriptions. So when I was joking about Wonder Boy and Night Trap Death Threats, that's the very first time I ever got one, was when I brought up subscriptions. So I'm a big fan of IndieBox. IndieBox is like, they do physical PC stuff. Every once in a while, you know, it's like really, really awesome. Other times it's like, eh. But like, I still have it, and I love it, and I know everybody there, and we're friends. The problem with subscriptions, and there's multiple problems, is I can't guarantee that a game's going to be out. For example, right now we're in peak season with Sony, and a lot of our games are delayed manufacturing-wise because Destiny and Assassin's Creed and Call of Duty. That happened, I can't say like, oh, these games will be ready. Because then you're just going to get like three random boxes at the same time because it was delayed for 3 months. That's the main reason. The other reason too is people feel like we're forcing them now to buy games they don't want. So, like, a lot of people weren't excited when we did Mutants. Because they were like, oh, it was really cheap, even though everybody loves EO Drifter, which is, it's like the same game, except one is Metroid ish, and the other is just more platform. They got really mad about that, and I can see people being like, oh, I didn't want this. So we feel like we can hit more people without the subscription. I personally like it. I'd love to. The idea is to one day implement maybe like a loyalty system. Like, hey, these customers have legit bought everything or almost everything. Let's offer this to them and say like, hey, this is, we'll give you a total for the month and like kind of like Humble Bundle. You can pay this amount now and guarantee all your copies. And that way we have an idea of like what we for sure know to print. And then everybody else can just, you know, play the rat race. The problem with that is that it brings up the thing of this isn't fair. And I understand that it is, and it is, because it is fair, because people have proven that they can. It's just like a credit card company doesn't give you a credit card if you don't have a proof of record of credit. I can't explain that to people. They just don't understand. So it makes sense. It's one of the reasons why we haven't done it. Also just because it caused a huge drama thing on Twitter and forums. But yeah, I'd love to do something like that. I personally think it's a great idea, but it does create issues. Anybody else?
So Lawbreakers came out like a couple weeks ago. Did it seem like a weird release for you guys? Because it's like not quite the Japanese obscure thing, and it's basically an online game. So the physical release kind of becomes pointless because at some point it's going to shut down and it must be like was there like any internal thing going on with that release specifically? Or is that just like what the loop team wants at a disc? Let's get them one.
Yeah, well, somebody's, so this was our chief finance officer, that's not the way cool it is, Ben's baby. This was like his thing. So he used to work at a bar owned by Cliffy in Raleigh, and then a lot of our devs actually did contract work for Lawbreakers, and or had, like, for example, Josh had been a tester on Cure Support 2, and we actually met Cliffy when we were in Scouts, which is also what it's all about. So we knew Lawbreakers was coming. You know, it was hyped up around our area because it was like, oh, you know, this is like our claim to fame in this area. We got Cliff and we got Epic. So Nexon was going to do it. Next thing we knew, Ben was like, hey, Cliff just told me Nexon dropped it and that they're not thinking about doing physical anymore. And, you know, that could be for a number of reasons. I've never been told the official reason. I just assumed that Overwatch, they missed their launch. Which is, you know, they were going to come out before last year, but then Overwatch came out. Shit. They were like, let's not do this. So then they spent another year of development to make it better. So he brought it to us, me and Josh, and he was like, hey, we should do Lawbreakers. And the first thing that came out of me and Josh's mouth was, it's online only. I don't want to do it. Because, like, for example, I had a chance to do a game by Suda, and I love Suda 51. That's why I did the Silver Case. That's why I made default pictures with him. Huge fan. They had a game that's online only called Let It Die. They got a physical in Japan for whatever reason, just because they love it more than we do. And it was offered to us kind of in like a half-joking way. And I was like, oh, look, do it. Like, it legit doesn't make sense. Like, it'll be a coaster later. So I was like, wait, let's not do it. So they brought Lawbreakers to us, and I said, no, I don't want to do it. And then Josh said, well, I'd like to do it because the notoriety, like, it'd be really cool. That's basically almost a AAA game at this point. And like, if you had gone to E3, it was all over the building. Like, they had their own giant display on the building. Like, it was prime, like, front and center. So it was really neat. And I was like, okay, I can agree with that. That'd be cool, because, you know, I'm always struggling to prove to people that we're a real thing. And if I can go to a dev and say, I've done Lawbreakers, like, everybody knows what that is. That would help. And I was like, but I don't want to do it. It's online only, and Josh agreed, and then came back and said, well, they're telling me that it should have something offline, like a tutorial. And it turns out, it doesn't. I said, okay, it has something, and like, you know, we can spin it in a way that, like, it makes sense, but we're doing this to help his team. His team was really excited for it. They were extremely hurt that Exxon said no for whatever reason. And they wanted to own something because they've spent the last, like, 3 or 4 years working on this game. But, okay, let's help them out because they are, you know, basically neighbors. It gives us a huge title to say we've done. And, you know, even if the servers get shut off, the disc has the base information. And I, for example, still play Phantasy Star Online. It's been reverse engineered from the disc. The same thing could happen to Lawbreakers if there was a fan base. The argument to other people is there's not going to be a fan base, there's Overwatch. But whatever, there's going to be like 10 people that still love it. They reverse engineered Star Wars Galaxies recently. That game really wasn't that great. So that was the idea too. Like, hey, this game still needs to be preserved regardless. I, for example, bought Star Wars Battlefront physically, even though it's online only for the most part, the first one. I still just prefer owning that. Same with Battlefield Hunt. Sort of okay, single player. But it's the same idea. I still want to own it physically regardless. I own like a really bad $5 copy of Battleborn. Never own it, probably never will. But I own it, it's on my shelf, and that's, I just wanted it. And the same idea went to Lawbreakers. So we signed it, and then Ben comes back and says, oh, well, it sounds like there isn't any single player, and they'd already announced it, and I was like, shit. And I was like, this sucks. And then Ben was really humble about the whole thing. He was like, look, I'll go on the forums and tell people, like, I really wanted to do this. This was my thing. The other idea, too, was for the PC guys, at least, we created what is going to be our best collector's edition. Like, we spent a lot of money getting, like, an embossed box. You can actually feel the sweat droplets on the guy. That's pretty gross. It has an actual leather book with fingerprints. Like, it's the Digital Society, they use fingerprints. It has its own lore. But the book has, like, the lore, and it's, like, written, and then the back is signed by all the developers. It's, like, a real official expensive leather book. It has trading cards, and then it has the game. And there's one other thing that's included. Postcard and sticker that were all custom made for this. So we were like, okay, at least, you know, that's cool. So I still like buying PC games, too. Even though, let's just be honest, it's on Steam, and I'm like, yeah, I just want it on my shelf. Just another thing to hoard. That was the thing, too. It's always a big callback for me and Josh, just making these things, because it's like a very big, hey, we collected these in the 90s and 2000s, and like, even though now everything's all digital, and kind of was sort of back then, too, like, to have those big boxes was just like such a cool feeling. Like, one of my favorite things ever was the StarCraft battle chest, like opening it up and having that giant book of lore, just reading that in the car, and being like, I can't believe I want to play this, and my dad and parents were like, grounded, and you can't get on the computer, and I'm like, well, I got a book. So, same thing with that. So we did it anyway, and I still feel like it was the best idea, we did the best we could. The thing we did with that title, though, is we did take the numbering off. So it doesn't have a limited run catalog number. We consider it a spinoff title. Kind of like when you go see a movie and they do a spin-off thing, and they're like, it's not canon. That's basically what this is for us. We publish it, but it's not considered part of the ultimate, like, the series. So if anybody's like, I'm collecting the full set, and then like they have Lawbreakers, and somebody can walk in and say, well, that's not really part of it. So that was that. It's all very much working with the developer. We say, hey, like, what kind of key art do you have? What kind of concept art? What would you like to do? And a lot of times some of the developers are like, well, we're really busy on our next game. We prefer that you, like, handle most of this, and we'll just give you approval. Or we get a developer that's really into it, sometimes too into it. And I'm like, I can't answer your emails every second. So we tell them, like, hey, we have a printing partner that's local. We can get it for this rate. We think the printing system would be good. We like to include this stuff. And it's like, well, what about this? Can you make this? And something really random, like a diary, like, which is what Lawbreakers have. Let's see. So then we get the proofs back. It's a very long process. That's why, like, Night Trap, for example, we started that months ago, just getting all that ready, because we needed to have a tray that specifically fit the cassette. Didn't have rival grounds. That's my only thing with, like, some of the other people that do what we do. Their boxes don't have trays, and it just shuffles. And, like, that's loose disc is already like the bane of my existence. So I need something that's fitted. So yeah, it's a very much back and forth thing. If we can, we try to, like, send them something. Especially Japanese owners, you have to mail that. We have to mail the contract to them. That's the weirdest thing. I have to mail the NDA to them before I can even do the contract. They're like, I never got it. And I'm like, well, I don't know what to tell you. Here's another one. I'll see you in a month. So, yeah, it's very much, like, together.
There's also
GOG.
We haven't thought about doing anything custom. We originally, it's like Indiebox when they first started with flash drives. And then people, but flash drives cost more than this, which is another reason why they switched. Also, classic PC games were this, like CDs or like, you know, actual floppy. So the idea with our PC releases was, let's do this, because it's like, you know, we grew up in the 90s, let's do what we remember. We did try with one game to do floppy disks, but it was going to be like, I think 1,000 something floppy disks. So we were like, let's print like 5 of these. This will be like its own thing, and it takes you like a year to install, because you have to sit there doing that. If you have a new computer that can run the game with a floppy disk drive, so it was like its own thing. So yeah, we thought about doing some crazy stuff, and probably will, because like those are always neat ideas, and they're just really random to us, and yeah, sometimes we're extremely receptive to that. They're like, that's making sense, let's do it. So, kind of like the cassette for Night Trap, we're like, nobody has a cassette player, and I'm like, it doesn't matter. So yeah, that's something I like to see, and I'm still pushing for that floppy disk game, but you know, insert 1 in 100, or 1,000. Have this weird relationship where, like, I know people there, they want to do it, but then Sega of Japan is like, no. So, for example, I mean, I can officially say this, Yakuza 5, which was something everybody wanted us to do, we wanted to do, it was our dream game. We even said in our documentary with My Life in Gaming, do Yakuza 5. There is this idea that if they didn't offer it originally, they consider it kind of a slap to the face to their customers. I don't think that's true, because I would buy it again. I've done that before. So the idea is, hopefully maybe one day I'll let you do that. The thing that we are considering trying to do is, a lot of people can compare us to the Criterion Collection. I'd like to reach out to somebody like Bethesda and say like, hey, you know, we'd love to reprint Fallout 4 or Skyrim with a brand new cover and a new case, and like make that limited. Like it's its own version. It's like made for collectors, and it's like a premium thing. So that's something I'd love to see people like doing, because like I wouldn't mind buying, well, you know, let's all be honest, you probably pop up copies of Skyrim at this point anyway. What's one more? Yeah, exactly. So I think that's a cool idea. I'd like to do that stuff. I would love to work with other developers. It's just like, the main thing I run into with other big publishers is, why would I work with you if I could do it myself? And it's like, okay, well, why won't you? So that was recently an argument I had with a big company. And like, they shot me down at first. I wrote this huge thing saying, like, I think this publisher versus publisher thing is the stupidest thing I've ever heard. And I think you should not be like this, because I'm trying to help you and your customers and myself by having this game. If you're not going to do it, then you should just not do it. That's dumb. You're like not helping anybody by not doing it. And eventually he was like, oh shit, okay, here's a person to talk to. And I was like, thank you. And I was like, I didn't think I was going to have to write this. But it seemed to work with that. And if it actually pulls through, like, I should know within a month. You know, that'll be like the biggest announcement I've ever personally made. I'd like to do that with other people. You got a question?
Yeah, is there anything that you can announce that maybe is not out there right now that the internet is talking about? Or can you mention something about like reproductions, official reproduction games
The official reproduction thing hasn't gone anywhere yet, because we're still building relationships with some of these people. And we're going to have to do just a traditional look at them before they understand how we can get the money. But the idea behind that is, like, we'll reproduce a rare Super Nintendo game that's officially licensed by them, because the patents for those are gone anyway. So, like, Nintendo can't get mad. But it'll be officially licensed by that publisher. Like, maybe, like, a cool Capcom game, maybe. Or, like, something from, well, there's a mod that just looked like the original R-Type. Like, we don't know who owns that anymore. That license is just, like, floating. We can find whoever has that. Have that officially stamped and approved. Like, if you need to make like a new box for it, one thing we wanted to do, especially was like Genesis games, because they had like 4 different boxes for those. We wanted to just have one standard box that people can actually put them on their shelves. So yeah, I'd love to do that. I don't have anything to announce yet, other than I'm trying to think what is coming. I know that Solomon Sanctuary, we announced the game, but the release date should be October. I have an official release date for the PS4 version. It should be in October. We ran into a hiccup recently, or a huge roadblock that I can't announce officially. You'll know soon, because you'll be like, oh, that sucks. It isn't that the meat is dead, so don't freak out. It's more of just like a huge inconvenience and headache and somebody getting involved that wants to take money from other people. So you'll see. We have to do what we have to do. We're just gonna bite our lip and go with it. That's how this industry works. But I think the biggest thing coming soon will be Salt Sanctuary. I'm currently working on that with Scott Studios. I'm trying to do whatever I can for like a collector's edition. I'll probably have a poster and a full menu. Anybody else? Yes.
As you start to work with bigger, like mid-tier and upper-tier main studios, do you look at doing smaller indie dev stuff too?
I don't know why you're asking that. The idea behind that is if I do smaller tier, I just want to make it more premium. Like, I want to make sure that their game is a collector's edition, so people are like, oh, I don't want to buy this because they're selling it for, like, our base is always 25. Like, oh, it was on sale for PSN all the time for $5. I'm not spending that much money for that. That's what people always say when that game sells out, but whatever. I have to deal with that on Twitter, and it's what drives me crazy. The idea is to make a collector's edition of it, like, make it premium. If I'm going to do smaller tier games, I have to have the developer say that they'll make a manual, or say that they'll at least help us make a manual. I have to have, like, a soundtrack, because we have other competitors that showed up, like, East Asia Soft, who we basically started with, now does what we do in Asia. And their version, like, we announced Ghostblade, and then they announced it, like, literally the day after, and both of us were really confused about that, because the dev never told either one of us they had signed with both. But they released their version, and it came with a soundtrack, and a full manual, and it was in a nice box. We were like, wow, we weren't going to do any of that. And now we feel like we have to, if we still do this game. So the idea is that our smaller titles, because I still like these smaller titles, I still want to own it. The problem is convincing customers that they need to own it. Like, a lot of times they're just like, eh. So the idea is that if it's cool enough to them, owning something that has a manual in it, a soundtrack, maybe if the game has art, a new art book, kind of like NIS does. They have their stuff. Some of those games are really small, but they like that package comes with so much most of the time. That's what we like to do. Anybody else? You can ask me, when did I get Night Trap? Contact the other person and say, like, oh, it did happen, Rabby Ribby.
Okay.
PQ got it. Same exact thing happened. The developer signed it, two different regions, not thinking that it would be an issue, and not realizing that people would still import games with Peggy ratings. Not me. I don't like Peggy ratings. but other people will. And we were both like, well, this game isn't big enough to sustain large runs. So they ended up canceling their Vita version. A lot of people blamed us for it, but I know everybody at PQ. And it's just because Europe is, like, basically saying, like, like, nobody wants to carry it, and like the amount they would have to print is really high.
Like you said, it's more expensive than getting more.
Exactly, so they didn't want to run the risk.
Okay.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
Anybody else?
Yes. Ratings. Noticed that most of the games don't have ratings, but then I got deeper, there was a rating sticker on the other side of the box. Is there a reason you don't print the ratings on the box? Or
so, well, now you know the roadblock that's coming. Apparently, we've been on their radar for a while, and the reason why we didn't is because legally the SRB is not required. It's not a law. It's 100% up to the retailers to enforce. And because we're our own retailer, we're direct to customer, we don't have a physical presence, we didn't have to do it. Sony was okay with that. People like Microsoft and Nintendo, though, do require it. But that's not why we're not on those. It's just that Sony was like, but like if you're selling it direct to consumer, it's not a big deal because there is a digital rating. And as long as like people can reference that somehow, it's not a big deal. Demo was originally going to get its own physical. The publisher was going to do it. Somehow it didn't work out. They canceled it. So they paid for this rating. There's two ratings at ESRB. It's called short form, which is digital only, and then long form, which is physical. It's all on their website. The physical ones you pay for when you do that, regardless if it comes out or not, you're in a contract that says, I will put this on the box, comply with all the ESRB standards. If not, I'm subject to fees and blah, blah, blah. It's just like signing a cell phone contract. So we did it. He didn't think anything of it because he was like, oh, you know, I thought maybe it was just void. And the ESRB had already been following us and kind of watching us and trying to figure out a way in, saw that we messed up, contacted us immediately and was like, hey, the dev is about to be subject to huge fines. You need to somehow add this onto your packaging. We're like, well, it's already being printed. And I have, like, I don't know what you want me to do. We're like, well, you can make stickers. So then we went through the nightmare of designing that and getting that approved and then sticking that to all whatever thousand, how many thousand that was. And then apparently after that, it is now, I guess they contacted Sony and were like, hey, we think this, they made a case to where, like, we support mom and pop shops. I think that's being used against us now because now there is our games in physical stores. And they're saying these people aren't being educated because there's no rating on it. It makes sense. And I'm not a personally huge fan of the rating system, but I understand why they're doing it. There's other reasons too, but it's something I knew I was going to have to get into if I ever got to Xbox and Switch anyway. So for me, it's just kind of like, oh, I'm getting the practice in. And it is another cost that sucks, and it is another process that I have to learn. But I was going to have to do it anyway, so future games will probably happen on there. I think we're clear for like a good month because all this stuff was approved before, like we had gotten grandfathered in for a certain amount of stuff. And then after that, you know, you'll probably end up seeing ESRB ratings unless something else changes. They haven't told us what the new thing is yet, so we're still waiting.
It's kind of a comedic irony
that
Minecraft was the last game.
Yeah, that was, we were really worried because like we announced that we're going to have a 32X version available through our rewards program.
Oh.
And it hadn't been approved yet. And then they told us, hey, you're going to have to start using ESRB ratings. And I'm like, even on this one? Because we're like, you know, really cool right now for not having it. And they're like, no, since it's already done, it should be fine. I'm like, oh, thank God. And, but yeah, there's some titles we're signing that, like, we're like, man, hey, you know, when you do a long-form rating, the ESRB takes a harder look at it. And we have a lot of titles that got digital, and if you get a digital rating, so this actually happened. It got a rating. It was just, like, I think it was E. And then in, like, one of the DLCs had, like, the word Dan. So they got really upset with the developer when they reviewed it for our version and was like, no, you now have to change the ESRB rating and you have to pay a fine. So our worry is that anything I sign that had a digital rating now has to go through this new process. They find something else that they weren't going to find and an M rating that somebody told only and it gets delisted. So it's one of those things where we have to tread lightly because we could cause a game to get taken down and that would be the ultimate irony in a company that's trying to preserve games like losing games. So it's kind of scary, but it's something we're preparing for. We got a whole system going down, and thank God Night Trap. Thank God they didn't come up with that right as we were doing that. And it was like after it was already being printed. Anybody else? Sure what's going on with that yet because they're still just focused on finishing the game, but see, when of two things will happen, or one of three things will happen. One, they just won't work with us to play Azure regardless of how bad that would be for their fan base. Because, like you said, people want to own both in the same collection. Two, we'll have an exclusive cover, and then we'll do it. Or three, we'll have an exclusive window of ours will come out first, and then PlayAsia will get their own. So one of those three options will happen. I hope it's the last two, and not the first. Because that was a concern of mine once they started doing Imperium, and I was like, well, I really like putting out their games, and now like they kind of like grow up and feel like they don't need me anymore. So yeah, hopefully we get that out. Wow. I'm going to talk for a while. More transitions? I don't know. Well, thank you guys. Appreciate it.